Hello, I'm coming to you on behalf of our Avondale Adventures Ministry. Back in February and March, the children of Avondale Adventures sold butterflies as a fundraiser in support of the theme, Showing Our Love Through Action, based on Isaiah 58. These butterflies were purchased by you in memory and in honor of loved ones. All proceeds were used to purchase items from the Presbyterian Giving Catalog for our brothers and sisters in need around the world. With your support, the children were able to purchase soccer balls and books for a refugee family relocated to Charlotte, two family of chickens that will supply eggs for food, feathers for blankets and pillows, and fertilizer for crops. 10 jerry cans that will help to transport water more efficiently, freeing women and girls to spend more time on enriching activities, and one fishing net that will help to ensure a livelihood and food source for an entire community in need. Thanks be to God for these gifts. Please join us in remembering and honoring those we hold dear.
In memory of Florence and Tom McCaffrey, in memory of Lillian and Joseph Shafield, in memory of Margaret Ball, in memory of Della Oglesby, in memory of Shelby DeBoard,
in memory of Philip Haig, in memory of Ed and Dewey Boswell, in memory of Julius Beatty Inman Sr., in memory of Luella Dietz Inman, in memory of Robert Payne, in memory of Katie Stout,
in honor of Nancy Dickerson, in honor of Mary Ball, in honor of all of our friends who are alone but together in our hearts, in honor of Aiden and Bradley DeBoard, in honor of Max Griffin and Taylor Shanks,
in honor of the gifts and talents of Avondalers, in honor of Natalie Thomas.
Good morning and welcome to worship here at Avondale Presbyterian Church, where we come before our God with open hearts and with open minds, rejoicing and praising the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. I want to thank everyone who participated in the Back to School Bash, where we collected school supplies for our Bethlehem Center friends. These offerings go a long way to help get the materials needed for these kids as they start a new year through distance learning. Also, I want to bring to your attention that on September 1st, we will be offering another virtual Taze service. This is a wonderful way to stay centered and connected to God throughout your week. If you have ever wanted to participate in our Taze service but never had a chance, then this is a great opportunity to experience it and to see if this is a spiritual discipline that is as meaningful for you as it is for those of us who participate in it. Those are all of the announcements that I have for now. So let us unite our hearts by offering together the call to worship you find before you. We gather together in praise and worship of our faithful God, because our help and hope rests always in the Lord our God. We bring our praises and thankful responses to our saving God. Blessed be the Lord our God, who is our security and home, and whose mercy and grace Free us from all that traps us. Blessings, reverence, honor, and glory be to the Lord our God. We come together to praise and worship our all-powerful God because we are confident in God's generous care over us. Our eternal trust is in the name of the Lord our God, who is our Maker, our Savior, and our eternal home. Confession is a time when we ask God an honest prayer to renew and redirect our hearts through the power of the Holy Spirit. Please join me as we offer our prayer of confession together, but then take a moment for your own silent and personal prayers before God. Let us pray. Oh Lord, please forgive my failure to be true even to my own accepted standards, my self-deception in face of temptation, my choosing of the worse when I know the better. O Lord, forgive. Please forgive my failure to apply to myself the standards of conduct I demand of others, my blindness to the suffering of others, and my slowness to be taught by my own, my compliance toward wrongs that do not touch my own case, and my over-sensitiveness to those that do, my slowness to see the good in my fellows and to see the evil in myself, my hardness of heart towards my neighbor's faults, and my readiness to make allowance for my own. O Lord, forgive.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. My friends, hear the good news. God is at work in the world and in each of our lives, working to heal, to reconcile, and to unite all as one, just as God, Christ, and the Spirit are one. Know that because of the work of Jesus, you are forgiven. All thanks be to God. Now, realizing that we are assured such forgiveness gives us a certain sense of peace. But as people of faith, we are not permitted to keep this peace for ourselves, but we are called to model it and to share it with others. So I want to invite you to take a moment to send a text to an Avondale family member saying, "May the peace of Christ be with you." And if you receive such a text, respond saying, "And also with you."
Our scripture passage for today comes from Mark chapter 12, verses 13 through 17. And following, please listen for a word from the Lord. Then they sent him some Pharisees and some Herodians to trap him in what he said. And they came and said to him, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Should we pay them or should we not?" But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, "Why are you putting me to the test? Bring me a denarius and let me see it." And they brought one. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Jesus said to them, "Give to the emperor the thing that are the emperor's and to God the thing that are God's." And they were utterly amazed at him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
In 1776, a Presbyterian minister by the name of John Witherspoon picked up a quill pen and signed his name to a piece of paper that was lying on a wooden table. Turns out he had just committed a treasonous act, because the document he signed was the Declaration of Independence. He was the only active minister to sign that document, and Presbyterians have been committed to civil service ever since. From the executive branch to the local school board, Presbyterians have seen it as their faithful duty to serve God in public office. In fact, 5 out of the last 9 governors of this great state have been active members of Presbyterian churches. As a denomination, we take our politics seriously. Serving in office is a calling, just like ordination. But it seems hard, doesn't it? It seems hard to enjoy politics these days. With political news shows that bring us politicians talking over one another at high volumes, with campaign ads that belittle, slander one another, with friends and family getting into heated arguments around political parties, it's no wonder
that things feel so divisive. And with 3 months left until the November election, we are finding ourselves involved in more and more conversations about politics. So we are spending a little time as a church having a conversation about how we, as faithful followers of Christ, engage in these conversations. And how do we honor our patriotic and our civil responsibilities as a way of living out our faith? Last week, we talked about perspective and how if we want to have politics be a part of our lives without our blood pressure rising every time the topic of the election comes up, then we need to have a balanced perspective, understanding that we are Christians first and foremost, and any political party or leader we align with always fall under the authority of God and our faith, and not the other way around. In our passage for today, we find the Pharisees. You remember them. They're the ones who are the Jewish leaders. They have studied for years and years the Torah, the Jewish Bible, and so they know it inside and out. And they can quote scripture and verse. They know all of the over 600 rules that any good Jewish boy and girl should follow, and they were very good and making sure they followed the rules. And they have invited their political enemies, the Herodians, to help and try to catch Jesus. The Herodians were the Jews who supported Herod. Now, don't misunderstand. No one liked the Romans, right? The Romans had taken over. They were oppressing the people of Israel. You want to talk about taxation without representation? There was no one in Rome lobbying or advocating for Israel's interests. And Herod was a Jew who had sold out to the occupying party. He was politically savvy, and so Caesar had made Herod governor over Israel. The Herodians were the political party that said, well, the Romans are going to be here for a while, so we ought to make the best of it. So they were both in it together to discredit Jesus. And the easiest way to do that is by publicly humiliating him, which they try to do by asking this question: is it right to pay taxes to Caesar? If Jesus says yes, then the people will become infuriated and stop listening to Jesus. If he says no, well, then he's bordering on the line of being treasonous, and he is likely to be arrested. They have pinned him in this catch-22 type of situation. So Jesus says, do you have a coin? May I see it? Please note that Jesus is not carrying a coin. I'll come back to that in a moment. Someone hands him a coin, and he holds it, asking, whose image is this? They said, the emperor's. Now, the coin had the profile picture of Caesar on the coin. But did you catch the second part of his question? The real important part? The part that Amanda had read? He asked, whose image and whose title? You see, the surrounding the profile picture were the words, Tiberius Caesar, son of the divine Augustus. So the coin is making the claim that Caesar is God. This is, of course, idolatry, a man claiming to be God, which, by the way, everyone is carrying around in their pockets, everyone, that is, except Jesus, who knows for a fact that Caesar is not God. One side note, I do love that the U.S. Federal Reserve has these images of significant politicians on our currency, but also has In God We Trust stamped there, as if to say, George Washington is great and all, but it is God that we put our trust in, not George Washington. So Jesus responds, give to emperor what is the emperor's, and to God what is God's? Meaning, the emperor can have all the worldly things, the little kibbutz by the sea, the new chariot with the chrome wheels and the Tesla emblem on the hood, the money with all their graven images. Caesar can have those, but give to God what is God's. And what is God's? Well, the things that were made in his image, the things that he claimed in the waters of baptism, things like you and me. We can never belong to Caesar because we are God's. So how do we live as God's chosen, God's claimed, God's people in a political world? Politic, incidentally, means governed, which means rules or laws for community, meaning how we are to live with one another. And Jesus had lots of thoughts and expectations about how we are to live with one another. One of the first books written on the topic came from St. Augustine in his book, City of God. Augustine, you may remember, was a man of great leisure and entertainment. He was a wealthy fraternity boy who was a party just waiting to happen. But one day, he realized that none of that made him happy. He wasn't satisfied with life or his behavior. And he was, or had, I should say, this major conversion experience, renouncing his former lifestyle and devoting himself to the things of God. It is then that he writes this book, and in it, he claims that we will never find all of the values of heaven in any earthly program, but we practice them, those values of heaven. We live into them as best we can right here in our moment and in this place, which means we have to be involved in the politics of earth as Christian people. You see, as Christians, we are called to be political. And by that, I mean we are called to be about the interests of Jesus. Because if we're going to be about the interests of Jesus, then we need to get involved in decisions and topics and thinking through issues with others. And Jesus' interest, which was good news for the poor, sight for the blind, healing for the sick, and release for the captives, all of those are political, and we need to be involved and work those things out together. But those interests are not the sole interest of any one party or any one leader. Just like Caesar was not God, no party, no leader is God either. It takes all hands and all parties to solve the interests of Christ. And the only way that is done is through humility. Because too often, it seems that Jesus' interests would be the same as my interests. Kind of like my friend who said, if I won the $7 billion lottery, I'd give my 10% to the church. So why hasn't God given me the winning ticket yet? It is in humility that Jesus' interests become my interests, and not the other way around. You know, the Declaration of Independence was drafted by the Committee of Five. John Adams and Jefferson were both on that committee, and Adams persuaded the committee to elect Jefferson as the author of the document. They spent tireless hours together working on this document. They were close friends. And as you know, the U.S. won its independence from England. Washington became the first president. After his terms in office were over, it came time to elect a new president. Adams is elected as president, and Jefferson was vice president. Both were from different parties, and they feuded all the time. By 1800, Jefferson, the vice president, runs against the current president, which was Adams. And I'm told that Jefferson, during the campaign, he hires a guy to write slanderous accounts of Adams, trying to go to war with France. And then, just before leaving office, Adams makes a number of political appointments to federal offices that caused Jefferson headaches and heartburn for the next 4 years. the relationship is broken, and they give each other the silent treatment for the next 12 years. No letters, no visits, no communication. They are so angry with each other. Well, years go by, and they both have retired from office, and a mutual friend gets them to check on each other. Adams sends Jefferson a book with a note inside. The two political heavyweights are now out of the game, far removed from the Capitol, and they slowly start talking to each other again. At one point, Adam tries to talk with Jefferson about their falling out. He says, "You and I ought not to die before we have explained ourselves to each other." Jefferson said, "Nothing new can be added by you or me to what has been said by others and will be said in every age." And so they let the matter drop. And as you know, they both died on the 50th anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. It is reported that Adams' last words were, "Thomas Jefferson survives." You see, the tragedy is that two of the greatest political minds squandered their opportunity to work together and accomplish more than they ever did on their own. If they had just taken the same collaborative energy they had harnessed during the Revolution and channeled it toward earthly and worldly American politics of the 1800s, just think of what they could have done. But that called for humility. Instead, ideology corrupted everything, and it ruined a great friendship for 12 years. And friends, I can't help but wonder if our divisiveness and our lack of humility between parties is causing us to lose the same opportunity today. Because Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers." And Jesus was most earnestly interested in peacemaking. But it seems to me that those who are being honored are those that slander and belittle their opponents. But Jesus says, "Blessed are those that cross the aisle." Because here's the thing. The problems of this world, they're too big for just one group to solve. We need churches and politicians. We need business folks and nonprofits. And we need individuals to participate in a process that finds solutions. And that is where you come in. Because God needs you to be a part of that. Whether you vote or do surveys or help around the party headquarters or run for office yourself, God needs us to be involved in the political process. As people of faith, people who will bring humility and compassion and a genuine care. Because if we as people of faith don't do it, then somebody else will fill that void. So I'd like to ask you to pray. Pray over the next 3 months for our leaders, the leaders that are active, and the ones to come. Pray for leaders of the federal level and the state level and the local level. Pray for the people of your HOA. Heavens knows they need it too. And if you find that you can't pray for a particular leader, then pray for their advisors, the advisors who are guiding them and resourcing them. Because God calls us to be active in this world, not passive. And God calls us to care about the interests of Christ, to act with humility, compassion, and care. My friends, we have been called for just a time as this. Hallelujah. Amen. My friends, in response to hearing God's word, let us affirm together what it is that we believe using the affirmation of faith you'll find before you. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and then calls women and men to all ministries of the church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people long silenced, and to work with others for justice and freedom and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, "Come, Lord Jesus." With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. My friends, prayer is significant to any community of faith. And so every week in your worship email, we include the names of friends and loved ones who have come to us humbly asking for prayer. And then we request that you would become familiar with the names and hold them gently as we go to God in prayer. Come, let us now unite our hearts in holy prayer. Lord, you are the God of wonder, the God of grace, the God of mercy. And we humbly approach you daily to open our lives to you, trusting that in your mystery and power, we will find ourselves walking closer and closer with you, and finding that your ways are becoming our ways, and that your thoughts are becoming more like our thoughts. Enable us to see your creation through the same loving lenses that you see it, that by doing so we might be a bit more patient with our neighbor, that we might show a little more compassion to the strangers among us. For we understand that it is only when we are truly rooted in you that we can be the light of the world. Oh God, you have shown us how through scriptures Jesus came to fulfill your word. He came to open our hearts and minds that we might better understand your message for all of creation. So as we read and hear, we see the message of hope that is your good news. Help us to take that message and proclaim it with confidence to the world around us. Allow us to share it with those that are ill and undergoing surgery. May we declare it to those that are homeless and hungry. And help us to use it to encourage those that are going through changes in their life and adjusting to a new identity or a new way of living. As your church, we pray that we may truly be a city on the hill, beckoning your people to come and rest in your presence. For it is when we worship you that we find ourselves spiritually nourished and rejuvenated and prepared to live life with a new purpose and a new meaning. Yet we understand that there are those in our community that for them life is a struggle, that facing the day is sometimes an uphill climb. Help us as a church to encourage and to support them. Help us to be right there with them through the valley experiences as well as the mountaintops. And may your spirit, may it remind them time and time again that they are precious in your sight, and that as the good shepherd, you will never let us go. And Lord, we pray for this world, which is always in flux. May our leaders be guided by integrity and noble ambitions. May our soldiers be agents of peace and not vengeance. May our civil servants be instruments of hope and trust and not driven by selfish motives. That perhaps through all of this, we may see a glimmer of what your kingdom is like. For we offer these, our prayers, in the name of the Holy One, Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. and give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, every week in worship, we have the opportunity to give thanks to God for the blessings of our lives, for health, for family and friends, for knowledge and meaningful work, for Avondale and the Church Universal, for food and shelter and resources that we can share with others. If you would like to give through our online offering, you can do so through the e-worship invitation that was sent to you this morning, or through the Avondale website, or you can send in a check to the church office. And thank you. Thank you for sharing your gifts to help love our neighbors and to bring about God's kingdom here in this world. My friends, I invite you to join me as we offer together the prayer of dedication you'll find before you. O gracious God, we affirm faith in your mercy as we bring you our offerings. May you use them to further your work. May our talents be useful in serving your people, and our time filled with obeying your will. The money we give is in response to your graciousness. May you accept it as part of our renewed commitment to Christ. For it is in his name we pray. Amen. My friends, as you go forth from this sacred time, go with the confidence of knowing that Christ is always with you, to hold you when you stumble, to catch you when you fall, to comfort you when you are hurt, and to rejoice with you in all of your life's celebrations. So as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's countenance shine upon you and grant you peace, now and forevermore, in a world that truly has no end. Amen.